with this. Well, over the last couple of days, been corresponding with Amanda Serrano, who wanted to make sure that I got her side of the story on several subjects, the Katie Taylor subject included. In reference to her purse for her most recent outing against Diana Santana, Amanda Serrano wanted the opportunity to tell her side of the story. She actually communicated to me that she's a fan of the channel, watches the channel, but it's the coverage revolving around her that she feels is a bit unbalanced. So in the spirit of fair and balanced journalism, I'll tell her side of the story in her own words, and all of you out there can make of that what you will. Now, in reference to that purse that she received for Diana Santana, a purse that was viewed with some skepticism, given that the fight was a small show, it wasn't picked up by a major platform.
Amanda said she got $25,000.
Received that news with some skepticism initially, because it was a small show, because it wasn't picked up by a major platform, and because it was reported that Jelena Marjanovic's purse for the Torres fight that was featured on NBC, you know, it was two times less than what Amanda had claimed to have gotten.
On an even smaller show.
But as it turns out, it appears that Amanda wasn't lying when she said that she made $25,000 for that fight. She has provided the documentation, the evidence that proves she was telling the truth. So many words, that has everything to do with her contracted minimum to take on a fight, regardless of where the fight takes place or who the fight is with.
She wasn't lying.
It's a similar situation to what we see with Terrence Crawford, and how, you know, Terrence Crawford, this is a guy whose contracted minimum is a multi-million contracted minimum, regardless of who he's in there with, whether it's, you know, Amir Khan or Kell Brook or Igis Kavalyauskas. It's that kind of situation. But essentially, Amanda wasn't lying. She was telling the truth, and she has provided the corroborating evidence that verifies that. In reference to the now defunct Katie Taylor situation, you know, Amanda wanted to get her side of things out there as well. And there are some very revealing insights there. But I told Amanda, you know, I let her know that
I'm not going to sugarcoat shit.
Not going to pull any punches. I'm going to be as honest as I can be with how I feel about things. And, you know, Amanda communicated to me that she made very good money for the Heather Hardy fight. I won't disclose the exact number due to the sensitivity of the subject, but she made very good money for the Heather Hardy fight. And, you know, one issue that she had is that the money for the Hardy fight was a little bit too close to the money for the Taylor fight. She was set to make more for the Katie Taylor fight, and even more than that,
a little more,
after having agreed to have the fight in Manchester.
Both with six-figure paydays.
You know, one issue that Amanda had is that she felt, from where she was sitting, you shouldn't make for fighting Katie what you make for fighting Heather, you know, even if it's just a little more. Those dollar amounts for those two different fights with those two different fighters, they really shouldn't be in the same neighborhood. That's an issue that she had. Furthermore, she communicated to me that, you know, before the Heather Hardy fight, you know, just before that, you know, they threatened to cancel the Heather Hardy fight if Amanda didn't agree to the dollar amount for the Taylor fight. Guess what that communicates to me is that she felt pressured to accept the dollar amount that she didn't necessarily agree with. But to salvage the Hardy fight, you know, she did what she did. She agreed to the amount. Amanda also communicated to me that contract itself ended up being voided, which I have reason to believe, because Amanda did end up fighting someone else. She ended up fighting Diana Santana. If she was still under contract, I don't think she would have been able to do that. Though there is the subject of the cease and desist letter that needs to be reconciled, that perhaps at least at that time she was still under contract, because, you know, when she tried to make that appearance on Exatlón, the people over there at Matchroom did send them a cease and desist letter. And as a result of that cease and desist letter, you know, she didn't get to make an appearance on the show. Kenya Enriquez ended up taking her spot.
That was months ago.
When that cease and desist letter was sent, whilst we were still all under lockdown as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. And, you know, very recently, Amanda got back into action, fought Diana Santana for a second time. I don't think she's under contract for, you know, Katie or any other Matchroom fighters here today. So what do I make of this? What is my reaction to these revelations? In the spirit of fair and balanced journalism, I'm going to be honest. I think there's a smidge, just a smidge, of truth to Amanda's contention that you shouldn't make for fighting Katie what you made for fighting Heather. Those are two very different fights that are on different scales. But be that as it may...
You accepted it.
You agreed to what they offered you, you understand. Whatever amount it was that they offered you for Katie...
It's an amount you accepted.
And that offsets everything else. Whatever it was, you signed on for it. You agreed to it. Even if you felt that you were in danger of losing the Heather Hardy fight, the Heather Hardy payday, even if you felt that way, you know, you're still at liberty to accept it or reject it. And you accepted it. When I spoke to Amanda, she admitted that Katie Taylor makes a lot more money than she does. So much that she can't even disclose it to the general public, you know, for fear that it might piss off the other girls. You know, she communicated that. And what that tells me is that you're aware who the A-side fighter is. You're aware who is the financier of the situation. In that situation, you know, you gotta be realistic. The big issue that a lot of people have with Amanda Serrano and her team is that they have tried to vilify Eddie Hearn for having provided career-high prices, career-high paydays, not just for her, but a lot of female fighters. That perhaps the dollar amount offered to her for a Katie Taylor fight isn't to her liking, it's still a dollar amount that she's not going to find anywhere else, fighting anyone else.
So how's he the bad guy?
And it sounds a lot like Amanda is trying to say that she accepted a dollar amount that she wasn't necessarily on board with due to pressure from Matchroom to accept it. But be that as it may, it still is something that you accepted.
Still is.
So you have to honor the terms of the engagement. And if you don't...
It's gonna look like you got cold feet.
I'll tell you how it looks to a spectator in what is a spectator sport. It's gonna look like Amanda Serrano perhaps got cold feet fighting Katie Taylor, because Amanda's okay to fight for less money than what they offered her for Katie Taylor. She's okay to fight a Jelena Marjanovic or a Sarah Mahfood for a way smaller price than what was offered to her to fight Katie. So what's the difference? I'll tell you what the difference is. The Katie Taylor fight is likely a harder fight to win than those fights. I view Amanda Serrano as the apex predator at 126 pounds. By the weight division. I don't think those girls can beat her. But with Katie, it is a different situation, isn't it? Because that's not at featherweight. That's at lightweight. That's at 135 pounds. And before you tell me that, you know, you'd be taking on sizable risks in that Katie Taylor fight, moving up in weight for it, need I remind you that, you know, Amanda won the WBO title at 140 pounds fighting Yamila Reynoso. That's before she even signed that three-fight deal to take on Katie Taylor. She stayed right there at 140, or just decided to move down to 135, she wouldn't be the one coming up in weight. Whose decision was it to go down to 115 pounds and fight Eva Vorobberger?
Have to sign on that deal.
That's the only reason she'd have to move up in weight and make her way back to the lightweight division. I'm going to tell you the truth. I think Amanda Serrano and her team need to put that Katie Taylor fight behind her, because there's nothing left to garner from that than more negative press. A lot of people take issue with Amanda and her team vilifying Eddie Hearn when, in Amanda's own words, this guy was ready to provide you with 2 six-figure paydays.
Two of them.
Do you see a lot of other outfits paying that kind of scratch, that kind of cash to the ladies? Matchroom is one of the few outfits that's out there that's trying to increase awareness of the sport, that's trying to increase the marquee value of the fighters. You can't make him out to be a bad guy when this is the guy that was set to pay you more money than anyone else.
So how bad could he be?
I'm going to offer Amanda Serrano a bit of marketing advice. There is nothing left to be garnered from that Katie Taylor situation aside from more negative press that she doesn't need. If she wants to focus on something, focus on the Marjanovic fight. Focus on putting pressure on Sarah Mahfood. Focus on silencing the critics by unifying those titles, unifying those belts. Put the Katie Taylor stuff in the trunk and forget about it. Because as so long as that subject is broached, those old wounds will reopen, and it's going to have an adverse effect on Amanda's public image.
You gotta leave it alone.
A lot of criticism levied towards Amanda for winning vacant titles, titles that champions weren't in possession of. That is a criticism that can be remedied by unifying the featherweight division, unifying with Jelena, unifying with Sarah.
You gotta leave that Katie Taylor situation alone.
Because it looks like what it looks like, and drawing more attention to it can only have an adverse effect on Amanda's public image, not Katie's.
There were other girls taking on the fight that she didn't take.
And those girls, they ain't getting three-fight matchroom deals the way that Amanda got a three-fight matchroom deal. So how's it look?
She's got to try to make people forget about that Taylor situation.
And I think the best way to do that is by unifying the featherweight division. I think that would help put this whole fiasco in the rearview mirror. Moving on, in reference to this weekend's big super middleweight contest, where Canelo Alvarez became the WBA, WBC, and Ring Magazine super middleweight champion in one-sided fashion, I saw many of the reactions that people were having to Callum Smith's performance. Callum Smith, who is confirmed to have injured the muscles in his left arm. You know, a lot of people were saying some not so nice things about Callum. He's a bum. He's no good.
Yeah.
Kind of short-sighted stuff you expect from the average boxing fan, you know. These guys are terrible. It's what they are. And, you know, I'm looking at this stuff and I'm thinking to myself, if it wasn't Canelo Alvarez opposite the ring of Callum Smith, if it were Jermall Charlo, if it were Caleb Plant, if it were David Benavidez that won in one-sided fashion the way that Canelo Alvarez won in one-sided fashion, this is not what these critics would be saying. This is not what they would have you believe. If it were any one of those guys, Jermall, Caleb, David, any one of those other guys, Demetrius Andre, Billy Joe Saunders, their supporters would think they hailed the moon and the stars for beating Callum Smith in one-sided fashion the way that Canelo Alvarez beat Callum Smith in one-sided fashion. To those fighters, Callum Smith would be the biggest, best, and most credible scalp on their entire resumes. All of them. Every single one of them. That's the reality of it. That's the truth. You want an example of this? Look at how Jermall Charlo's supporters reacted to his performance over Sergey Derevyanchenko. They think he hails the moon and the stars because he shut out that guy.
They didn't think Danny held the moon and the stars when he beat him.
And we know that Gennady Golovkin had just barely beat Sergey Derevyanchenko. It is safe to say that Jermall performed better against Sergey than Gennady did. Than Gennady did, at least. But better still, they think Jermall hails the moon and the stars for fighting a guy that those two guys beat already. Rather uneven view of the sport and the fighters that participate in it, taking shots at Callum Smith when Callum Smith would easily be the best scalp on Caleb Plant's resume if he collected it, Jermall Charlo's resume if he collected it, David Benavidez's resume if he collected it, and the list goes on. That it's not that Callum Smith is a bad fighter. Don't ever be fooled. It's not that Callum is that bad so much as Canelo is just that good.
That's all it is.
You know, if it were either Caleb Plant, David Benavidez, or Jermall Charlo that beat this guy, they'd do with Callum Smith what Wilder's fans do with Luis Ortiz. They'd talk him up. They wouldn't talk him down. But because it's Canelo Alvarez that beat the guy, they want to treat the guy like he's no good, like he's a bum, when in reality, he was an unbeaten champion ahead of this fight, the Ring Magazine champion, and what was the consensus number one at this weight. I give a fuck about your eye test. I give a fuck about your anecdotes. That's where the guy was ranked. And these ain't alphabet rank standings we're talking about. We're talking about divisional rank standings.
So miss me with the bullshit.
So no, it's not that Callum is a bad fighter. It's not that he's not a credible scalp. He'd easily be the best scalp on your favorite super middleweight or middleweight's resume.
It's not that he's a bad fighter.
It's that a lot of you guys are fucking hypocrites. Short-sighted, feeble-minded hypocrites. Because I reiterate, you wouldn't be saying any of this stuff. You wouldn't be discrediting Callum Smith if it were either David, Caleb, Jermall that beat him. You're only doing that because it's Canelo Alvarez and because you're upset that he didn't fight your favorite guy when your favorite guy is interchangeable with this guy. That's what it is.
No better, no worse.
So just give the kid some fucking credit. This is the third world champion. He's fought in sequence, in succession. What's your fucking sweetheart doing? Who they gonna fight? And finally, in other news, I'm sure most of you have heard by now that Joseph Diaz versus Shavkat Rakhimov and Patrick Teixeira versus Brian Castaño, his own doubleheader, is being planned for February. Very revealing news, as, you know, a lot of people thought that the next time we see JoJo, we'd see Tevin Farmer opposite the ring of him. Those two guys were supposed to have a rematch, and it appears that's not going to be happening. It's important to note that Shavkat Rakhimov is JoJo Diaz's IBF mandatory challenger. That being said, you know, yeah, Rakhimov's is mandatory, but you're telling me that the last couple of months there wasn't enough time to put together the Diaz versus Farmer rematch? I'm not understanding. You know, I didn't see the IBF pressuring JoJo Diaz to have that fight. I didn't see a deadline.
Yeah, I didn't see one either.
I didn't see a purse bid ordered, and It gives me the sense that, you know what, there actually was a window of opportunity there to have the Farmer rematch, and for one reason or another, it just didn't happen. I don't know what the state of Tevin Farmer is here today. I don't know if the kid's even still with Matchroom Promotions. Is he with them or is he not with them? What's going on? Tevin and JoJo, those two guys fought in January of this year, at the top of the year. That was months ago. Here we are at the end of 2020, and we haven't seen the rematch, and you're telling me that at no point at all, at no point between the time that COVID shut everything down and things started opening back up, you're telling me there was no window of opportunity to stage that rematch? I find that quite hard to stomach, quite hard to believe. Joseph Diaz has since inked a pact with the people over there at MTK Global. Does that have something to do with anything? Does that have any significance in this conversation? I don't know.
Looks sketchy.
For what it's worth, I think the card in and of itself as a package promises to be an entertaining card. Joseph defending his title against Rakhimov and the long-anticipated Brian Castaño versus Patrick Teixeira fight. Patrick Teixeira being the reigning WBO champion at 154 pounds. I anticipate that the title will change hands in at least one of those fights. And I am leaning towards the Teixeira versus Castaño fight. I think there's going to be a new champion crowned in the junior middleweight division. But I really am at a loss for words when it comes to Tevin Farmer. What he's up to, what happened to him, and what is his status here today? The guy doesn't even have a fight book. We haven't heard a whole lot from that kid. And we know that the rematch isn't happening. So, you know, just keep your eyes peeled for this from Golden Boy Promotions by way of DAZN in February of next year.